At one time or another, we all do it. We go shopping. However, some of us do it a bit more enthusiastically than others. I'm Nelson Davis, executive producer of Making It. While women earn less than men, only 78 cents for every dollar a man earns, there's still a lot of power in the purse. Women make more than 80% of the buying decisions in all homes. Marketers, both large and small, just love to see them coming. And today, you'll meet two entrepreneurs who've tapped into women's apparel. So you'll see fashion by women for women on this edition of Making It. Making It, featuring inspiring personal stories of struggle, triumph, and success from America's small business communities.
Hello and welcome to Making It. I'm Lynette Romero.
And I'm Emmett Miller. Research indicates there are several reasons why women shop. Some do it to lift their spirits, some purchase on impulse, others are just hunting for a bargain. One young lady who didn't find a good deal on the rack discovered an even better one, her own business. And it all started when Nicole Sains thought a pair of pants in the store were way too expensive, so she made a pair of her own.
Good idea. Nicole was still in college when she started her fashion business. She made apparel and handbags for fellow students. She even had to set up office hours in her dorm room to supply the demand. Now, at age 25, she's making it in the bikini business.
It's called Nicoleta. The company designs and distributes high-end swimwear to department stores and boutiques. The line's marketed around a fictitious Cuban vixen who goes on romantic escapades around the world.
As you can imagine, with such an upscale brand, quality materials are imperative. However, what Nicole saw wasn't always what she got. She ran into some manufacturers who didn't meet her standards, not to mention she had a hard time convincing retailers to buy her line. She mailed out 70 business propositions and only landed one client. Ziomar Galindo shows us how Nicole's business grew piece by piece.
It seems that when you least expect it, opportunity knocks. For Nicole Sains, dabbling in the garment industry was merely a hobby. While attending USC, she made handbags and eventually turned her love for apparel into a business as a top designer for Nicoleta bathing suits. Nicole, tell us about the name of your company and its origins.
Nicoleta started just because my name's Nicole and I'm the youngest of two, so my family and my mom and my dad always called me Nicoleta. So when I started the handbag company, I needed a name for it, and it just happened. I'm like, you know what, Nicole's already been taken by Nicole Miller, why not Nicoleta?
How did you get into the apparel business?
Well, I was an event, I wanted to be a wedding planner and event planner and at USC, and it just so happened that I had a sewing machine, I sewed a handbag, my sorority sisters loved it, and the orders began to fill in my dorm room. I sold 2,000 handbags out of USC, my dorm room, and I just decided, you know, I already did my internship, let me see where this might take me, and then I got into bathing suits.
You became an entrepreneur right out of college. What was your thinking behind such a bold move?
Well, I kind of felt like I got in knee deep, and I decided, you know what, I've already done the corporate structure, I've already done my internship, I paid my dues. Not realizing how many more dues I'm gonna have to pay as an entrepreneur, but I just decided with my parents' support that let me just go for it.
How do the bathing suit seasons affect your manufacturing cycle?
For a small business owner, I don't produce bathing suits all year round. I sell and then we produce. So I start production in October, November to start delivering for January's. And then from January until about July this year, I was delivering, and then it all pretty much stops, because you start creating your line for next year, end of May to July, and then you start selling all over again.
You transitioned from making handbags to producing bikinis. Why?
We had a feasibility class. I didn't follow through with the end of the business courses because I already graduated, but I wrote my feasibility on handbags and realized it wasn't feasible for me to sell to sorority girls for the rest of my life. And that's when my whole concept really changed.
What happens when the manufacturer doesn't produce the quality that you're looking for?
I stumbled across a couple different contractors who did not produce like quality products, and so therefore like that's your name out there. So finally I've got an amazing facility, Quality Beachwear. They They work for all the top names, and they've really taken me underneath their wings and provided me with a great product to sell out in the market.
You have an inspiring story of how you landed your account with Nordstrom. Tell us about that.
I called up Janet Yeh. She was the West Coast buyer for Nordstrom's at the time. She picked up the phone, which is rare, usually goes straight to voicemail. And I asked her, I'm like, hi, you know, stumbling over my words. Hi, this is Nicole from Nicoleta. I want to get a meeting with you. How do I do that? And she said, just get on a plane and come up to San Francisco. They love the line, and I've been with now, hopefully, for 3 years. This will be my next season with Nordstrom. So my first season out, I got that account.
Nicole, walk us through the manufacturing of your product. How do I get this? The warehousing, the manufacturing, the shipping of it. How does this come about?
I make my samples. I go out and sell them to my clients, and I carry this traveling salesman kit all over the United States. Sell my product. I round up all my orders. From there, it's a huge calculation in terms of buying yardage for fabric, spaghetti, thread, elastic, all the little findings you see on it. And then I start production. And so from one bathing suit, it goes from like 5 to 7 different procedures, 4 different machines, table work, ticketing, price tags, hanging rack, and then we have to ship it, which is another story.
You began 4 short years ago with over $20,000 in sales, and now you're up to $150,000. Where would you like to see your business go over the next 5 years?
5 years, I definitely want to still focus on swimwear, maybe get a couple more resort wear cover-ups. In terms of selling, just really grow the brand Nicoleta at high-end department stores and select boutiques across the U.S. and hopefully internationally. And maybe 10 years down the line, you know, open up a nice little boutique so I can really bring the brand alive, because there is a story, a really special story about Nicoleta, the actual character that I'm creating.
How creative. And you know, those bathing suits look so much different than anything
else
you see on
the rack.
Yeah, they
really do. Good for her. She picked up the phone and called Nordstrom.
Yeah.
Good for her. Well, Nicole's philosophy, I want to call her Nicoleta. Her philosophy is an inch is a cinch, but a yard is hard. She says, don't take on too much at one time.
And if your hands aren't full of work, your brain should be full of ideas to keep your business productive. In our Secrets of Success, Bonnie Montevecchi suggests you tap into your creative side.
How many of you have as much money as you like, the perfect job, or can go on vacation whenever you wish? Right. Well, there are ways toward those goals by being more creative, tapping into the right side of your brain, the home of creativity and intuition. How? There's some fun strategies. When you're problem solving for business, think about the second right answer, or the third, or even fourth right answer. Don't be set on a certain course of action. Or learn to change your question. Flip it around. Look at it with new eyes. It can definitely help you see a different spin on your business. Einstein said, imagination is more important than logic. You don't want to be part of the flat earth society. It's not impractical or foolish to be creative. Try it. It can lead to great problem solving and a lot more fun.
Bonnie Montevecchi is the owner of Celebration Station. You can reach her at 866-672-6664. And if you're interested in hearing more Secrets of Success, log on to our website at makingittv.com.
And from sewing to singing, we're going to show you how Wendy Williams Stern turned her musical talents into a thriving fashion business.
Honoring the American dream of business ownership, Making It is being brought to you by Honda, the power of dreams. By Southern California Edison, for over 100 years, life powered by Edison. And by Comerica Bank. We listen, we understand, we make it work.
Welcome back to Making It. When a woman walks by with a nice handbag or ensemble, it doesn't go unnoticed. They say something about her. It gives people an idea of her style and her taste.
One entrepreneur decided to come up with a flavor of her own. Wendy Williams Stern started out as an R&B singer, and then she traded in her mic for a sewing machine.
She launched her own line of handbags and clothing called Bath Coal, meaning heavenly voice. For startup capital, she used money from her singing residuals, and she also had to borrow from relatives.
And now Wendy's Needle is busy fashioning designs for Hollywood A-listers like Nicole Kidman and Cher. Her purses are custom made. They use imported leather and lambskin. But sometimes the fabric gets stretched too thin, as it were. Human resources are light, and the workload could be heavy for Wendy and her husband. In her story, you're going to see how she holds those threads together.
A lot of our products are unique. I think that the custom t-shirt that we make, people feel very special because they can pick what color they want, they get to pick the symbol. It's something that they're almost creating themselves, and they find it just, they're really beside themselves when they get their own little shirt that they made. So I think that's a really special touch.
Wendy Williams Stern is a long way from her upbringing as a child. As the youngest of six, who all wore clothing made from the same fabric, she longed for her own distinctive style. From here, her enthusiasm for design and sewing blossomed.
Once I made it to junior high school, I learned how to really craft and sew my own things. It was the 80s, so they were kind of wild. Those outfits were crazy, but I enjoyed them. I made clothing for all my girlfriends, so they had really special, unique, you know, outfits when we would go out. And from that point, I had a singing career, which kind of slowed the sewing down, but I always made my own clothing. And once that slowed down, I started making clothing for my friends that were in the business. And so for special events like Grammys and, you know, these big parties that come up, I would make really unique items for them to wear. And from that point, I started a business and decided to do special pieces.
Turning her love for designing into a business, Wendy began Bath Cole in 1998. And launching a leather handbag line with imported leathers from Italy was no modest venture.
The amount it took to finance the business initially wasn't much, but as we got into it and really established that we were going to start working in leather, I'd say we put about 15 to 20 grand at the very beginning. Leather is very expensive. Hardware, researching the hardware, trying to make certain buckles, you know, if you want to design something from scratch instead of using something that's already there, can get very expensive. Manufacturing of our bags comes from finding a manufacturer first. Sometimes you can do it here in the States, and a lot of people choose to do it overseas. I haven't gone and done that yet. I'm not going to say never. But you find a manufacturer, and you just go in, you place an order, and 4 to 6 weeks is usually the time period, and you get your product back.
Wendy decided to try her hand at t-shirts, which took her company to another level.
Our t-shirts were in People magazine, and from there we knew that we had to find some help to get into a lot of stores. A friend of mine actually introduced me to this rep who is based in the California Mart downtown Los Angeles. In her accessories showroom, she has a lot of different lines, including ours, and from there they have a list of many people that they send things out to. People also come 3 or 4 times a year into their showroom to shop. And that is how we got a lot of our stores as well.
Wendy's husband, Eric, helps run the company and focuses much of his attention on marketing the line.
A lot of the marketing can be done from seeing some of our products in the whole celebrity connection is a very, very important thing at this point. If, like, let's say Halle Berry did have one of our bags in the past, she was in a lot of magazines. People can find out from there, you know, that they want it, and they'll see our information and go to the website. My newest line of handbags was inspired by an old movie that I was watching called Gaslight, and I saw, I think it was Ingrid Bergman, holding one of a bag with that was a pouch, and I just loved the way she was holding it on her arm. And from there, I just started making a bag. I have had many times when I was a little discouraged. There's been a period where there were months when I had no inspiration and felt like, how can I continue doing this company when I don't know, I don't have any more creating in me? But it does come back. I think it happens with all creative people. You go in and out and you just believe in what you're doing and you can keep on doing it.
But there's more to business than just the designs.
I hate the bookkeeping. That is not my favorite part of it, but it has to be done. We do have an accountant. But it's something that you have to do, and I usually do it late at night, you know, when everything else is done. And that is a challenging part of it.
Luckily, Wendy has a supporter in her corner.
My husband works with me, and he is a great motivator, because when I do get down, he has the complete opposite personality of me. He's very, very energetic and upbeat, and sometimes I'm just mellow. So he is there he's my champion. You know, he just keeps everything going. He's a great help, like I said, with when we have to go 3 or 4 or 10 different places. He's going to 5 and I'm going to the other one. We are now in early production for a new line. We have new line of t-shirts as well as a new line of handbags. So the whole process is kind of starting from the beginning all over again. You've got to start with your production. You have to source all of your leather. Once you get the design, then everything starts from there. Also, you need to get into your PR, which you find out which magazines you get into. You possibly get them on celebrities. And so we're at the beginning again.
It's amazing where you can get your inspiration. Watch an old movie, Ingrid Bergman, what is she wearing? What's her purse look like?
That's perfect, I'm telling you.
And
your stuff looks great,
yeah,
honestly.
Yeah, it really does.
You know what, this time around, the couple's investing 50% more capital into launching their new line, and they continue to rely on creativity and resourcefulness to maximize their modest budget.
Well, when it comes to shopping, it's the moms that wear the pants. Don't miss our studio guest, Nora Lee, the author of The Mom Factor. She tells us how to get mothers to loosen up those purse straps. And watch your screen for info on the apparel industry. We'll be right back.
And here's how you can reach today's featured entrepreneurs. For the first, her name is Nicole Sains of Nicolita. She can be reached at mynicolita.com. And for Wendy Williams Stern of Bath Coal, log on to bathcoal.com. And now, here's Lynette with our featured studio guest.
Thanks, Emmett. Their market is sometimes ignored, but moms have a lot of economic power. Mothers often determine where the dollars go, from family entertainment down to her husband's socks. So how do businesses get moms to spend with them? Here with the answer to that question and more is Nora Lee. She's the author of the book, The Mom Factor, and an expert in targeting that audience. Nora Lee, welcome to Making It. We appreciate it.
Thank you. My pleasure.
So it's true. Moms really have a lot more power than I think sometimes we even realize.
Oh, absolutely. We're huge.
Can we talk about what you see as the next important business trend in relation to that?
Well, I think if you're a small or medium-sized business, you need to focus on customer service. That's the next trend. The marketplace is full of value, but what it is really rare is great customer service. And if you can hook moms in by creating a relationship with them, then you're on the first rung to a long line of loyal customers because she influences so many buying decisions.
Right. When you talk about that customer base of moms, how large really is it?
There are 105 million women in the United States. 82 million of us are moms, and 32 million of us have kids at home. We spend about $2 trillion a year on our
That's
families.
Pretty big.
That's the same as the country of Great Britain, same purchasing power.
Now, when you talk about looking for a bargain, cheap doesn't always mean good value. How can you sell value to your customers?
Well, value is a package deal, really. It's selection, its price, and its quality. But more importantly, it's what's wrapped around it, and that is the way the business looks and feels when you walk in the door or access it online. The way you treat your employees reflects the way you treat your customers. Value is a package deal.
So can you give us some specific tips about that customer experience?
Moms are very particular about many things. Some of my favorites are health and safety. Mm-hmm. If they're going to take a kid in somewhere, they don't want to take them into a danger zone. If you can provide a setting where they can do their job efficiently, mm-hmm. moms shop on a continuum. And on one is the to-do list. Everybody has those where you check off stuff. If you can combine things for them on the to-do list and be efficient, oh, they love you because it can be as simple as having a delivery service or the ability to call in something ahead of time and get it prepared. Look around, see something that you can combine with your business to make the shopping experience more efficient.
Diaper changing tables are really important.
Excellent choice.
I'm always looking for a diaper changing table. Also, when you talk about health and safety, you kind of got to get down on your hands and knees and see what the dangers are.
Yes.
Because when you're shopping, you might not have your eye on the child every single second, but you know, you always got the child right there and you want to make sure that they are safe. So it's really
right.
important.
Get on your knees and look at it through a child's eyes.
And think like a mom, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now the money is in mom's purse. Obviously,
right.
We're talking about how we control the money. Now how does a good business owner get the mother to spend their money with them?
Well, moms are emotional creatures. We're very relationship driven. And you have to understand that about them. They want to create long-lasting relationships with you. So if you do things like address the efficiency, address the customer service problem, make their lives better so that when they come in and spend money, they actually feel good about it, mm-hmm. and not like they're being robbed or held at gunpoint, mm-hmm. then you've got them, because we're very loyal.
So as a mother, your spending changes, obviously, after you become a mom. But you do kind of take that with you, whatever you were buying before. How does that work? How do things totally change when you become a mom?
Oh, you look at the world very differently. When in this, I understand you have a young child.
I have a little 13-month-old, yep.
Oh, excellent. At that stage, you're looking at diapers and safety locks and car seats and strollers. Well, mine's 15. I'm looking at private schools and amplifiers and guitar lessons. Mm-hmm. But all of those things would not be part of my repertoire if I weren't a mom.
Right.
So I'm buying in at least three different directions every time I buy.
And so for 18 years, you're thinking about your child, you're thinking about your family, and you know, probably beyond that.
Absolutely.
But there's a real strong customer base for a long time.
Absolutely. And actually, when we get to the point where we send our kids off, we're usually dealing with parents at that point.
Right, and grandparents. Okay, thank you very much. Great information, we appreciate it. Now coming up next, we'll tell you how you can get in touch with our studio guest, Nora Lee, so don't go away.
Steeped in the entrepreneurial spirit, Making It is being brought to you by Sempra Energy, a Fortune 500 energy services company committed to building a diverse supplier base. By Bank of America, higher standards. And by The Boeing Company.
And if you'd like the ideas that Nora Lee shared with you, you can contact her at www.momfactor.com.
And for small business questions and solutions, visit our Entrepreneurs Forum at makingittv.com. And there you can also buy a copy of today's show.
So did you believe before this that moms had so much power?
I would have said that there are many couples that I know where the female makes most of the decisions. Like, the guy comes in to buy a car, and it's always like, well, wait a minute, you know what? Bring your wife back, because we know it's going. I didn't know moms had such buying power.
I love when husbands say, I have to talk to my wife. I love that. It's very important.
Like, that's a given.
Yeah, that's good.
If you don't, the car will be coming back.
That's like, yes, honey. I like that, too.
I didn't like it in purple, honey.
Yeah. Well, that does it for today's show. I'm Lynette Romero.
I'm Emmett Miller. Thanks for joining us. Hope to see you next time here on Making It.
First time I saw one of my products in a magazine, I think I couldn't believe it, and someone actually called me to let me know that it was in there. So I was very excited. It was wonderful.
One of the fastest growing segments of small businesses are home-based businesses. So fast, in fact, that Newsweek magazine reports that more than half of all U.S. households will be involved in some sort of entrepreneurial enterprise this year. The explosion of affordable technology is making it all possible, of course. Fax machines, the PDAs, and the internet. This is all bringing dreams of business ownership closer for many Americans. I'm Nelson Davis, executive producer of Making It, and we'll answer some home-based business questions and more on today's show, beginning right now. Making It, featuring inspiring personal stories of struggle, triumph, and success from America's small business communities.
Hello and welcome to Making It. I'm Lynette Romero.
And I'm Emmett Miller. Thanks for joining us.
Did you ever hear the story of the little engine that could? Well, home-based businesses are fast becoming part of the engine that fuels the U.S. economy, churning out more than $314 billion a year.
Our first entrepreneur is part of that force. She's Cynthia Tucker, owner of Ladybug Productions. She plans special events and always has. From Girl Scout cookie drives to high school proms, if there is a party to be had, Cynthia was in charge.
Despite coming from a long line of entrepreneurs, Cynthia started her career working for entertainment giants, first Disney, then DreamWorks. But her dream was always there, the dream of working for herself and doing what she loved.
She launched Ladybug Productions, but when her bank account dwindled to almost nothing, she nearly gave up on her dreams. Correspondent Ziamara Galindo has more.
I've always felt that failure is not an option, that I knew that I was going to own my own business. I knew that it was going to be event planning and wedding planning because it's my passion, something I absolutely love.
Indeed, it's Cynthia Tucker's undying love for event planning, which has led to 4 years of steady growth for her Ladybug Productions.
What exactly does Ladybug Productions do?
Ladybug Productions is a special event and wedding planning company where I have clients that are nonprofit, corporate, as well as private individuals that sometimes will hire me to put a private party on for 8 people or weddings.
Prior to starting her own business, Cynthia enjoyed success at Disney, then literally landed a dream job, an in-house position planning events for DreamWorks. But all that would soon be trumped by divine intervention.
The pastor was anointing everyone, and I prayed at the altar, "Lord, is this my time to start Ladybug Production?" And 2 weeks later, I feel Spirit spoke to me, and I turned in my resignation and started my company on my birthday, September 27, 2000.
Cynthia, how did your experiences working for Disney and DreamWorks prepare you to take that entrepreneurial leap?
I was interacting with Steven Spielberg, with Jeffrey Katzenberg, a lot of the high-level execs there, putting on events for them, and I would oftentimes just stand back and see how they worked, how they networked. And having that experience and that corporate structure then allowed me to know how I was going to run my business.
For Cynthia, working from home gives her a big advantage.
I like the fact of not having a high operational overhead. My mortgage is also what I would be paying rent if I was to have an actual office. And I actually like my home.
However, in the beginning, clients weren't exactly beating down the door. At one point, Cynthia started to succumb to self-doubt and sent out her resume.
And I didn't get one phone call. Not one. And I knew the job market was tough, but I just thought my resume was going to stand out because of the experience that I had. And I didn't get one phone call. And I think it was intentional. It was at when I was at my lowest that I turned towards my picture frame that I'd shared that has the ladybugs that said, "Trust in God." And I felt I had not trusted in God like He wanted me to do. He wanted me to start Ladybug Production, doing what I love. And I lost trust in Him. When I got that trust back is when my company picked back up.
What has been the largest event to date in terms of size, scale, production that you have produced now?
I'd say one of the largest ones that I worked on and really enjoyed doing was the Lifetime TV show that I did for called the I Do Diaries, my sister's wedding.
Tasha?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Cynthia.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
It's so nice to meet you.
You know, everybody wants to get that $1 million event.
That Trista and Ryan event from The Bachelor. How do you convince a client that you can handle an event of that magnitude?
I think experience speaks for itself. I tell a lot of my students, I also teach wedding planning and event planning, that experience is what's going to get anyone over in this industry. Minus the fact that I've only been in business for 4 years, I've been doing events for over 10 years. So that speaks in and of itself.
How have your gross revenues grown from the beginning to now?
This is a good question. When I left DreamWorks, I thought that I was going to be making the same amount of money that I did my first year. I was very, very optimistic and actually made a third of that my very first year. So it was a humbling experience that I feel that I needed to go through. And since then, my revenues have actually picked up so that I'm making more than what I used to do, what I used to make at DreamWorks.
The Ladybug website has been a cornerstone for the marketing of Cynthia's business. Some of her clients have even come from overseas.
The internet has been really great because I also have a public relations background. I have my degree in communications. I know how to produce PR. So I've been in Ebony Magazine. I've been in several publications where I've just promoted myself. I send the press kit and promote myself that way.
Not only is Ladybug Productions the name of her company, Cynthia says the moniker has a more personal significance. It was bestowed on her by her mother.
She said, when you're ready to start your company, your event planning company, and this is while I was still in high school and college, you should call it Ladybug Productions. And I said, come on, Mom, I need a mature name. It sounds like I do children's events. Nothing wrong with children's events, but I need a mature name like Platinum Events. Yeah. And she said, no, your company should reflect who you are. And that's who you are. You're Ladybug. You're my Ladybug. So I kept the name Ladybug Production, and it's the best branding I've ever received, because when people hear Ladybug Production, they've seen a business card, they know that it's my company.
See, Mama always knows best,
yeah,
doesn't she?
Yeah, she does. And she's getting business from overseas, too. I guess that website's really taken off, man. One of Cynthia's most successful marketing tools is showing pictures of the events that she's done on the internet, as we mentioned, but she says she does miss having foot traffic or drop-ins, and one day she plans to move her business out of her home and into a storefront.
Well, turning now to secrets of success. Have you ever wondered how you could become a sales superstar? Well, it's as easy as learning your ABCs. Here's motivational speaker, trainer, and author Leon Howard Shepherd.
You can become a sales superstar by practicing the ABCs of sales success. Letter A, attitude. Attitude is everything. With a positive attitude, you will achieve 10 times more than you will with a negative attitude. Having that positive attitude means that when you run into an obstacle or challenge, you would view it merely as a bump in the road and not the end of the road. B, build rapport. Building rapport means to establish a relationship or make that connection with your customer. You see, customers don't like to buy from people trying to sell them. However, customers like to buy from people who show an interest in them. And letter C, continue to follow up. Most sales opportunities are lost due to a failure of following up. However, studies show that sometimes it takes 5 to 7 follow-ups before a customer will finally say yes. So continue to follow up, but never give up. So again, letter A, attitude. Attitude is everything. B, build rapport. Make that connection with your customer. And letter C, continue to follow up and never give up. By practicing and applying the ABCs of sales success, I guarantee that you will become a sales superstar.
A guarantee, all right. Well, if you would like to find out more about Leon Shepherd and the Shepherd Group, you can email him at www.thesalesmotivator.com. And for more secrets of success, you can log on to our website at www.makingittv.com.
And coming up next, the Yoruba religion inspires one entrepreneur to create an all-natural skincare line, creams, lotions, oils. When we come back.
Supporting the entrepreneurial spirit in America, Making It is being brought to you by Southern California Edison. For over 100 years, life powered by Edison. And by the Boeing Company.
Welcome back to Making It. Americans have always had the entrepreneurial spirit, and the numbers bear it out. The latest figures from a national research firm estimate that close to 36 million Americans have an office in their household, and that number continues to grow.
Home-based business is the topic of today's show, and there are many reasons people choose this option, including costs, flexible hours, and mastering one's own destiny.
And in the case of our next entrepreneur, Shani Chen, the reason was a skin rash. Shani started her career as a print and a runway model, but she realized the world of fashion is fleeting, and she decided she wanted to work as a television writer.
Now, that choice forced her to move from one coast to the other, but the change in climate proved disastrous to her skin.
She created a cream to ease her discomfort, but after several months of experimentation and testing it out on friends and family, she found something that worked.
With a proven product, she thought she could go into business, right? Well, she didn't find any success seeking a small business loan.
With a great idea and no money, she had to figure out a way to turn her miracle cure into a profitable venture.
Necessity totally bred invention. I had moved to LA from Miami, and I got a severe case of dermatitis. So what ended up happening was I broke out. I bought myself a plane ticket to go home to Miami for 3 days. I sat on the beach. Everything went away naturally. So from there, I knew when I had to come back to LA that I could get rid of it or not get it again, better yet. And from there, I just did a lot of research. I knew what I kind of needed to do to take care of myself. So I just wanted to make stuff for my friends and my family that around me that had dry skin too, and I knew that they could benefit. So that's how I started. We make body butters, which are 100% oil. They're salves. They're great for elbows, feet, cracked heels, knees, toes. Body lotions and creams are great for everyday dry skin. We have body oils, shower gels. We have sugar scrubs and salt scrubs.
Shani had a job at the bank when she convinced one of her friends to try her product.
I would experiment with her, have her try the new stuff. She was my guinea pig, try this, and in May, she, for Mother's Day, she has 7 aunties, and she placed her order with us, and she told me she wanted me to make our products for her aunties, so that was my first order, Mother's Day.
And it was a hit?
It was a hit. They came back for more, and I think from then, you know, kind of gave me the confidence that I knew I had kind of had something.
Deciding to spread her wings, Shani ventured out to a local flea market and asked one of the vendors if she could share her booth space. She made $140 on her first day. It was soon after that that she met her now fiancé and business partner, Joe D. Jones.
Jody came in the picture about 2 years after I kind of was in the mix. I was working a full-time job. Our best friends actually got married, and he was a groomsman and I was a bridesmaid at their wedding.
Well, the very first day I met her, I just saw pure joy and beauty. I think that I was in New York, and she came to New York for the wedding. And we had the tuck shop, and I'm walking up the street, and she's coming down the street. I didn't know who she was, and I was like, my God, who is that? Uh-huh. But she was a vision, like an angel that she is.
The friendship grew into a partnership of both love and business, and Shani contemplated quitting her job to focus on the company full time.
Oh. I think that that's the biggest thing for
fear.
People wanting to start their own business is that there's a big fear and self-doubt that you don't have what it takes to succeed. And I think when we talked about her leaving Citibank, she struggled with it because it was security and she didn't know how to let go of those strings. I said, okay, if you want to stay at Citibank, stay at Citibank, but know that it's going to take you a little longer to get where you want to get to. And as soon as I said stay at Citibank, she said, you know what, okay, how do we do this?
A family friend gave them a loan of $2,000 and the couple took a business course to help them get started.
Business 101 with how to write a business plan. That was the key element for us. So we took a 10-week course, I think, at UCLA. So it was a workbook, and it was just basically pushing us to kind of make sure we got our homework done so that we could have a complete product at the end of the class. And that's really what was our blueprint.
I knew that instant growth had to happen. So I said, let's just double everything. If you're doing one fair, let's do 5 fairs. You know, if you're at one store, let's double. If you're 4 stores, let's just triple that. Let's do 15 stores. So things of that nature. Right now, we're in 15 stores. We have 3 reps, 1 main soldier that pulls in, you know, at least $300,000 to $400,000 a month for the company.
But on a day-to-day basis,
so much to do, you know. And I think the hardest part is that we are only 2 people, and we have. There's never enough time to get everything done. With Jody, he does a lot of the marketing. He's responsible for the aesthetics of what the company looks like, creating the celebrity buzz, getting it to people, you know, to keep the energy high. We put on events as well, and he's responsible for putting on the events that we sponsor and co-sponsor together to continually be out in the market. I'm manufacturing. I love to make the products. I love to come up with the different types of products, you know, being it a body butter or a scrub or a gel. And he's great with, you know, helping me put everything together, labeling, finishing up, cleaning up the bottles, you know. It's a full manufacturing process.
But business is not always bliss.
For example, we were recreating the labels, and Jody was on the designing them, and I was trying to express my feeling of how I would like it to look, and I'm describing trees and leaves and, you know, birds, and he just couldn't, you know, you have to translate that into an aesthetic image, and that was a rough process.
20% of their sales come from their virtual store on the internet, but they've learned that growing a business is still a challenging process.
We've just took a course with Millionaire Mind, you know, the peak potentials, which was excellent, because what I was saying before, basically, one of the main things as a home business you have to really keep in mind is that you have to manage your money.
While the bottom line is always key, the real benefits are immeasurable.
It's really rewarding. It's handmade. It doesn't get any better than that, you know? It's love in there, and there's something just special about something like that, you know? So we keep continuing to do it. It's a lot of work, but it's a lot of fun. People are just really receptive. When you hear somebody say, I just got rid of my dry skin, man, it's just, that's that's a satisfaction in itself.
Now, see, the hard part is doing it as a couple.
Yeah, they look like they're doing it well, though.
Yeah, I mean, they really have this magical energy together.
Yeah. You want to know what Oshun means?
No,
it's an interesting name, isn't
it?
In case you're wondering, the name Oshun Body Care actually comes from the Yoruba religion. Oshun is a deity representing love, sensuality, and prosperity. And Shani chose the name, she says, because the Oshun is considered the goddess of beauty.
Seems to fit that. Still ahead, home-based business expert Ken Mann has some tips on how you can start a business right under your own roof. And here's how you can get in touch with the entrepreneurs you've met on today's show. You can reach Cynthia Tucker with Ladybug Productions at ladybugprod.com. You can contact Shani Chen and Jody Jones at Oshun Body Care. Their web address is oshun.com. And now here's Lynette Romero with today's studio guest, Ken Mann.
Thanks, Emmett. Ken Mann is chairman of the Los Angeles chapter of SCORE. It's a nonprofit organization committed to mentoring small business entrepreneurs. His own home-based business, Offsite Services, grossed in excess of $4 million last year. Wow, that's fantastic. Welcome to Making It.
Thank you, Lynette.
So your inspiration, we want to know how you did it. So first question, what's the first step a person should take before starting to work from home? What's the one thing they have to do?
Well, actually, there's about four parts to the first step, I think. One is to really do some self-examination and determine whether you're the type of person that can work from home and get your work done, as opposed to someone that needs an office environment and the other people around.
You have to be a self-starter.
Exactly.
Okay.
Secondly, I think if there are other people living in your home and you're contemplating a home business, you better talk to them and find out if what you're planning to do is actually going to impact their lives and you think you can work together.
Right.
Thirdly, I would recommend that you check in the city that you're located and make sure you can get a business license for the business you're planning to do at home. Oftentimes they won't acknowledge it or allow it. And then I would write a business plan along with a cash flow projection and take both of those documents to SCORE so we can evaluate them.
Okay. Now, it must be a little bit difficult sometimes to separate your business expenses from your household expenses. How do you do that?
You really need to keep them separate. At the beginning, you can probably leave them alone, but if you plan to grow your business or sell your business at some point in time, the people who are interested in it are going to want to see your separate financial information.
Okay, I'm thinking of starting my own business from home, working from home. How long should I wait to quit my 9-to-5 job? What do you think? I mean, I know that's a tough question. It depends on the person. But what do you think? What are some of the things we should think about?
Well, I think the good rule of thumb would be to make sure that you're making enough or close to enough money to support yourself before you let your day job go.
Easy to say, isn't it? Yeah. A lot of, you kind of mentioned this before about juggling your personal and your family relationships while you're working from home. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
Sure. As a matter of fact, I started working at home in 1985, and about 10 years ago, my other half began working at home as well. And that really changed things because now two of us were in the home mm-hmm. all day long, working from our offices in the home. And it created some conflict between the two of us. So those are the kinds of things you really need to think about before you go forward.
It really is a learning process. You kind of learn as you go.
Exactly.
A little bit. Tell us about SCORE LA.
SCORE Los Angeles is one of 386 SCORE chapters nationally. There are 10,000 volunteers across the country. We have 71 of them here in LA County. We counsel in over 35 locations here. We give about 15 workshops every month on business subjects. And our counseling is free, along with email counseling, and our workshops are low cost.
Now, over the years, you must have seen a lot of trends with issues surrounding people who work from home. What do you think about the internet and all of that? That must have made a big difference for a lot of people being able to work from home.
Exactly. A good case is my own business. I basically have customers all over the United States, and I'm able to work with them via phone, email, mm-hmm. and web presentations.
We're so mobile, you don't even have to be at home. You can be in your car, you can be at the beach, you can be just about anywhere.
Very true.
Right? You see some other trends happening in the future?
I think a lot of major companies are beginning to cut back on office space and allowing people to work at home because of this ability to communicate with the corporate office from their homes.
And is that a good thing, do you think, in terms of, you know, obviously that's a good thing for people who find it easier for their own lifestyle, but what do you think in terms of the economy and the workplace and workforce? Is that a good thing?
I think it's a very good thing. It cuts back on a lot of commuting, allows people to live their lifestyles a little more fully, cutting that commute time out.
People are a lot more productive.
I believe
so. A lot happier. Okay, great. Thank you so much. Good information. We appreciate it. And we will tell you how you can get in touch with Ken and also reach SCORE's Los Angeles chapter right after this break. Stay with us.
Where small business is the big idea. Making It is being brought to you by Honda, the power of dreams. Also by the Disneyland Resort in California, where you can experience a whole new world of magic at every turn. And by Sempra Energy, a Fortune 500 energy services company committed to building a diverse supplier base.
Okay, you can reach Ken Mann at scorela.org.
And if you'd like to get a copy of today's show or to find other small business resources, just log on to our website at www.makingittv.com.
Your dad had a home-based business, didn't he?
That's right. When I was a kid growing up, he had his office in the house.
Yeah.
And we knew that, you know, when the door was closed, you had to be quiet. You couldn't
Do
make
not
a lot
disturb.
Of noise. Yeah, and we used to have to answer the phone, you know, according to the business. And so it was actually fun.
Said,
it was,
honey, can you bring me some cookies?
I could never go, Dad! No, I had to be on my best behavior, absolutely.
Well, that's the way you have to. I mean, if you don't set up your time and your timing perfectly, then it doesn't work.
Yeah, that's right.
That's it for our show this week. I'm Emmett Miller.
And I'm Lynette Romero. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time right here on Making It.
My father is an entrepreneur at heart. I have it in my blood. So it wasn't really hard for me to understand what it takes to get up there and hustle to make it happen. But it was just like, how, you know? So that was great.